On September 6, 2019, Toyota Boshoku Corporation, an automotive component manufacturer based in Japan, a trusted supplier to the global powerhouse Toyota, suffered a staggering financial blow, hemorrhaging nearly 4 billion yen, a sum that translates to approximately 37 million US dollars. Why? Because an employee was tricked into sending this significant sum of money to the wrong bank account. Posing as a business partner, hackers sent carefully crafted emails to the finance and accounting departments, containing payment details to the threat actor controlled bank accounts. This attack is called Business Email Compromise, and just between the years 2013 to 2022, the FBI estimated that it cost almost $51 billion in losses worldwide.
A BEC is really about a threat actor trying to get access to your account so they can do a better job of impersonating you as an individual or a business. So they'll compromise your account, be like, okay, I can see that Bob's Phishing sends invoices to you regularly, $5,000 a month, every month. Yeah. I'm going to send one with Bob's Phishing, but instead of Bob's, I'm going to have B0B Phishing. And I'm going to send you an invoice for $5,000 before he does. And I'm going to put an inbox rule in your account that will redirect his expected one into your junk email and make sure it's read.
Yeah.
So from your end, you're getting the exact email that you get every single day or every single month from Bob's Phishing, but the domain is slightly different. And that's called domain spoofing, where they're trying to replicate the domain of an expected email coming in. And especially if you're expecting to pay that money every month, that $5,000, that $10,000, you're not going to question it. Yeah. And it's going to be maybe 1 or 2 months when Bob's Phishing is like, why aren't we getting paid anymore? I thought we had a good thing going on. And when you realize, oh no, we've been paying it every single month. And then you look back and you realize that you've been sending it to B0B's Phishing. You can be a victim in two ways. You can be a victim of the business email compromise itself, which means your account is personally compromised. Or for example, you could be a victim of BEC or business email compromise as a result of someone whose account has been compromised, messaging you, for example, with an invoice and being like, hey, could you please pay this to these bank details? And then you pay that. And that's where a lot of time we come in as Gridware and we define, all right, who are the parties who could potentially be compromised for this misdirection of funds to occur? And then we start ascertaining evidence on your side and determining, were you compromised or was someone else? Typically what they'll try and do is associate you by name. So for example, my name is Steve. It's not actually, but we'll call in this example, I'm Steve. So, you know, they might say, okay, this is a business owner. He's a sole trader. His name is Steve. And he works at a company called Steve's Building. So it's steve@stevebuilding.com.au. All of a sudden, they know his name, his company, and they can probably find his address and other things like that publicly available online, including his phone number and his family through social media platforms such as Facebook and those kind of things. They'll try to use that publicly available knowledge and attempt that as your password because they know that's something that's close to you. What they can also do with your name is look up your name and see if there's any personal Gmail accounts or Hotmail accounts or any other personal accounts that have been leaked in previous breaches. And in that could be a list of clear text passwords or hashed passwords even. And they can then attempt to get those passwords and try them against your business email account.
Yeah.
And that's called credential stuffing, where they will take the password from a previous breach, potentially completely unrelated to your business account, but from maybe one of your personal accounts, and put that into an attempt against your business account. Their attacks typically range from threat actor to threat actor. Sometimes you will see them go straight onto a phase such as propagation, where their pure aim is to spread this compromise as far as it can go. So this looks like sending emails to all of your contacts with a phishing link, just like you might have fallen for, and trying to get them to fall for it because you're a trusted email. And so that results in potentially another, say, 50 people getting compromised, and those accounts do the exact same thing, and it propagates out like a massive web. And all of a sudden, there's thousands of accounts compromised. So that's sometimes a sign of what's called an initial access broker, or an IAB. And what they do is they propagate all these kind of phishing emails using trusted accounts, and then able to go sell those credentials and those access online in the dark web, and they can provide as much detail as they want. They could be like, here's an account, I'm not sure what's on it. Or they could be, here's an account, it has access to invoices, it has access to HR information, medical records. They can know all of that and put that up on the dark web. So let's pretend, for example, Steve's not a sole trader. He actually has a large company with a lot of employees, but they find just online Steve's email address, steve@stevebuilding.com.au, and they know that the head of finance for the company, his name is Josh. So now they're gonna try josh@stevebuilding.com.au. And so it'll be first name dot last name at domain or at website, essentially. And as soon as they have that, they can just get a company list and they can just start slamming all the accounts with brute force attempts. Typically what we can see is impersonation. So you might receive an email from a client or someone that looks like a client when in reality, it's not them and they're not actually compromised. They just impersonate them in them and guessing essentially what they might say to you typically. Impersonation tactics by threat actors are not as effective as when they actually get access to your account. With impersonation, there's ways that people might be able to pick up, oh, that's not the, like, you know, that's not me, how that person speaks to me. They normally are much more formal, much more casual when they talk to me. But if a threat actor is able to actually gain access to your account or their account, they know what your communication typically looks like. And so they can use that to their advantage to impersonate them better. So yes, a larger corporation means that you have technically more avenues for the threat actor to try. You have a wider attack surface to try as a threat actor the larger the company is. But that's not to say that small companies won't get targeted. A lot of the attacks that I've seen, these large misdirection of funds as a result of a business email compromise, have actually come from sole traders. So the conception that, you know, you won't get targeted because I'm a small company, why would I get targeted? I have no information that's valuable to anyone. I'm just a small fish in a big pond, is not necessarily true. You, as a sole trader and as a small business, are actually seen as more of a target because you're easier. So a lot of these smaller business, a lot of the small businesses and sole traders have a lot less security funding and as a result, less security standards in place. So this results in a lot of the time them being targeted quite heavily by cyber criminals because they know that they might not even have simple things such as multi-factor authentication in place, which makes their attack a whole lot easier to perform and a whole lot easier to get persistence into an account. A lot of the times when these small companies get attacked, that is when they decide, you know what, I should invest in cybersecurity, and it's always a bit too late. It's always when they're out the excess for cyber insurance, or they have to pay upfront for an investigation, or they've lost tens to hundreds of thousands of dollars as a result of a misdirection of funds. A couple thousand dollars could prevent it, even cheaper, completely free security policies they could have put in place, could have prevented all that money being misdirected. And so threat actors will try a lot harder to get into bigger corporations because there's a lot more money in them. Smaller businesses, they'll try very simple novice tactics to try and get in. And a lot of time they work because the lack of cybersecurity funding. So typically how these transactions work is the threat actors will get you to send money to a bank account that is actually owned by a money mule. Now these money mules may not even necessarily know they are a money mule. They could just be accounts that they're kind of like not aware of, or accounts that were set up using their tax file number or details that have been breached in a previous breach. And so they're unaware that they're money mules and they're having money shoveled through their name essentially, and then distributed from that account to other accounts. And then they can be diversified further into cryptocurrencies and your money is almost impossible to recover. So these money mules can also sometimes be aware of these kind of attacks and know that their account's being used and can take some sort of a commission of that as well. So that's typically, is seen quite often in scams where, you know, people are actually physically shipping off gift cards or sending cash through the mail. So those kind of money mules are also very present. A lot of the business email compromise investigations that I've done have revolved around the real estate industry, and especially conveyancers, who are typically the ones who handle the money in a transaction for a home. With a lot of Australians trying to enter the property market at the moment, this is becoming a much more prevalent attack that's utilized. So all it takes is one individual in the email chain to be compromised for a misdirection of funds to occur in the purchasing of a property over email. For example, the buyer of the property or the real estate agent or the conveyancer will be compromised, and the threat actor will then use that to either impersonate or directly send from the conveyancer's mailbox emails that are directing the user to send money to a bank account that is owned by the threat actors. It's important to know that this can happen at any point in the process of buying a property. So we've seen it from at the very start of the conversations, of the negotiation, but we've also seen it just as the settlement's about to be made. So they'll say just before it gets to the period where you're supposed to pay the money, they'll come back with, "We've updated our banking details recently, please pay it to this account," instead of the one mentioned previously. And so people just be like, sure thing, I'll do that. And you then send it off. Now, a lot of the times before you send any sort of money, especially that kind of money, the first thing you want to do is call up the person you're sending the money to. Give them a call, it'll take 5 seconds and could save you a world of pain after you've had your money misdirected. I would highly recommend going to the person you're sending the money to's actual webpage and getting the phone number there, because what threat actors will do is they'll change the phone number in the signature so that you call that phone number if you do want to verify anything. And of course they'll be like, yes, completely legitimate, pay it now. So you want to make sure that you're going about the right process of actually validating that it's legitimate. So go to the website of the conveyancer, find their legitimate phone number, or if you have a known contact there, call them up and be like, "Hey, just received this email that you've requested we change the banking details, or that you send me some money. Just want to validate that these are the correct banking details to send the money to." I personally think real estate is one of the bigger targets for a few reasons. The first of which being is a lot of the time you have people who are buying for their first time, so they're not sure of the processes and they're not sure where they're supposed to send the money to. You know, it's a big amount of money as well, so these threat actors can know, you know, they could possibly get 200,000 in a transaction, or most of the time, no less than around $50,000 per transaction. So it's big money, and a lot of these conveyancers are lawyers. So a lot of times they have a lot of reputation around them and they're trusted. That's why they target the conveyancers especially, because they're trusted people and they'll have a lot of backing of other conveyancing jobs that they've done. So there's that trusted workflow that they'll walk you through the process of buying a property. Another reason they get targeted so much, a lot of these conveyancers are that small to medium business, or are potentially a lot of times sole traders. And so they don't have the funding or the backing to put good cybersecurity policies in place, or the knowledge that that's even what they should be doing. Very quickly into a business email compromise or misdirection of funds, the blame game begins. That's going to be the conveyancer being like, "You should have called me before you transferred any funds," and the buyer being like, "Well, you sent me an email with updated bank details. I just did what you were telling me to do." But in reality, the process was to call if we ever changed banking details. And so the blame game quickly starts in relation to these incidents. And a lot of times it is hard to put the blame down, because it's just, at the end of the day, a series of unfortunate events. When you're trying to assess the cost of a BEC, there's a few factors you've got to take into account. You've got the cost of the actual BEC, or potentially the misdirection of funds, but you've also got the reputational cost to your company. As a result of a BEC, we're not just talking about misdirection of funds, we could be talking about private information that you have with your clients being exposed publicly. All of a sudden, you've got a massive reputational cost to your company that you might not ever be able to get back. You could lose a lot of your customers, which means you lose a lot more money than you're expecting. You could lose a lot of time trying to get through potentially legal battles after, or even just trying to recover your account, which is just also lost time and money. Getting trusted customers back, and if it's a big breach, and you've got medical records, Medicare cards that are leaked, you have passports that are breached, you might have to notify the public you've been breached. And so when someone looks up your name, the first thing that might pop up might not be your website, but rather this company recently exposed in data breach. A couple of hours to maybe max a day or so. to get in contact with your bank and notify them, hey, I think I've accidentally sent money to the wrong bank account. Can we please freeze this? Can we please get in contact with the other bank and get them to freeze it? Because money will move really quick. Once it gets into those fraudulent bank accounts owned by threat actors, they will then distribute it further into additional bank accounts, overseas bank account, cryptocurrency, and it'll be almost impossible to get that money back. You know, you could be out couple hundred dollars, like in a CEO fraud attempt where they get you to send the gift cards, or you could be out millions.